You know, these long rambling poetical sagas there, they're all very well. But very often in the world of poetry, as in any other artistic endeavor, very often less is more. Less is more. The only exception I can think of to this is Phil Spector. More was always more. But he's out of action right now, so it looks like the minimalists won the day. And I don't entirely mind that, because you see, I embraced minimalism in 1958 after reading a volume of poetry by Mr. Gary Snyder, back then the king of the beatniks, right now the head of the Haiku Society worldwide on the Pacific Coast, Gary Snyder. Thanks to his poetry in 1958, in which I read a volume of, I was a very impressionable child, and the message I got was, he's walking in the footsteps of the Buddha. He's walking in the footsteps of the Buddha, and as such, I ascertain that material possessions merely provided a roadblock on the highway of enlightenment. And from that day, I determined to rid myself of any extraneous material possessions. As a 9-year-old, it wasn't difficult, but I tried to drag these. I've tried to drag these virtues into late adult life with some degree of success. And I was recently in a position to ratify my lifestyle choices in this regard, for you see, I was appearing at the Glastonbury Festival at the same time as the king of minimalism himself, the Dalai Lama. So the minute we got there, I said to my guy, Mr. Johnny Green, drives me around, I said, Johnny, I says, listen, forget about signing in at the production office or any of that bullshit. We've got to track down the ramrod of this outfit, the head honcho, the big cheese, the big cone. I guess what I'm trying to say is the man who owns this spread. And he won't be around in all that rock and roll shit either. Don't forget, he's a farmer. We got to track that guy down, check the perimeters. We went checking the perimeters, and there he was. I don't know his name. You know that guy who runs Glastonbury? What was he? The guy with the non-threatening Islamist beard. Farmer Giles. That's what we call him. Farmer, got track down Farmer Giles. Anyway, there he was. We checked the perimeter, and there he was, just like I thought he'd be. We drove up to the gate, and there he was, up to his elbows in animal ordure, brandishing some exotic rural implement or other, doing the important work on the farm. I wasn't disappointed. Anyway, we drove up to the gate. I didn't get out of the car. I was wearing suede shoes. Show business. Show business. I was there in a show business capacity. Anyway, I wound the window down, stuck my head out. My good man, I said, far be it from me to drag you away from your onerous bucolic activities. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Dr. John Cooper Clarke, arguably the most elegant poet in the English language alive today, but that's not important right now. You're in a position to introduce me to the Dalai Lama. I don't know why I affected this Richard Burton voice. Seemed like a good idea at the time. You're in a position to introduce me to the Dalai Lama, and I'm glad to do this for personal reasons, for the spiritual. How wrong you are, Dr. Clarke, he said. How wrong you are. Your reputation precedes you, sir. Please do not be misled by my beshitten raiment. For you see, I am the proud owner of a library card. And as such, I'm well aware of your prodigious poetical gifts. And would deem it an honor to introduce you to the Dalai Lama. And you know what? That horny-handed son of the soil was as good as his word. 3/4 of an hour later, there I was being introduced to the Dalai Lama. We shook hands, the whole of my right-hand side sobered up. Special guy. Special guy. And that's when I told him what I just told you now, Gary Snyder, 1958, getting rid of material. I said, anyway, you're a busy man, Your Excellency. Long story short, I've got it down to a George Foreman grill and a bottle of disinfectant. What do you think? What do you think? And his reply, I've only ever forgotten it once. He said, Jesus, Clarke, you want to get some shit? With that in mind, minimalism, right? That means the less the better, doesn't it? Take the limerick. Everybody loves a limerick, right? I've circumnavigated the globe nine count and nine times, reciting poetry all the way, and take it from a professional. The limerick is the punter's choice. This is one of mine. It never happened. It's not a true story. It's a hard lesson to learn that just because something rhymes, that don't make it true. But I'm sure that this never happened. Why? Because I made it up. Two ugly sisters from Fordham took a walk one day out of boredom. On the way back, a sex maniac jumped out of a bush and ignored them. But I can even do less than that. I'm such a minimalist that I can do less than a limerick here. Now I'm a minimalist, but I'm also a rhymer. So that means I can't do anything less than two lines. Otherwise, what's the second line going to rhyme with when there wasn't a first line in the first place already? You see the stylistic problem that might be. So this is my minimalist masterpiece. It's a two-liner. Don't expect to hear this. Oh, by the way, it's a free country. If you're a blank verse aficionado and a minimalist, then by all means, go ahead and write your one-line masterpiece, you stingy bastards. But my version goes like this. Don't expect to hear this one on the World Service of the BBC. Why? Because the subject matter is a sore point at the BBC at the moment. It concerns aberrant sex. And I call this one necrophilia. Fed up with foreplay and all that palaver. Abacadabra.